Sorry, good evening. Right. So welcome to the first session on SBR. And this is one of the most critical and important paper. Why I say it is critical? Because many a times you may find that people are working in the accounting domain. And this paper, especially when it comes from the IFRS background, so it becomes very, very relevant. Not just for clearing the ACCA, but to work in any accounting, you know, in any accounting or auditing firm, right? Or maybe an accounting profile, right? So this paper becomes very, very important here, right? So just want to confirm one thing before, you know, before we move on. How many of you has already done financial reporting, which was F7 paper? Or how many of you have got exemption? And this is the first paper. Okay. So most of you must be the chartered accountants or, okay, great, great. So I can see mostly are coming from the exemption route where everybody has got the exemption here, right? So have you guys gone through, right, those who are chartered accountant, has anybody gone through the new accounting or financial reporting paper on Ind AS? Fine. So it means that many of you are coming from the older old syllabus, right? It's okay, right? So the reason why I was asking you that, because IFRS, right? Because IFRS and Ind AS is around 98% similar. Right, it is about 98% similar, right? When there is a similarity, it means that if you know Ind AS, yes, you would know mostly the IFRS, right? So there you may not find lots of challenges. However, right, we will try to go this way that you know, whenever we cover any topic, right, it will give you confidence that you are very much clear with that, and we will try and take some examples from the books also, right? So first of all, you know, since it is the first session, first of all, what is strategic business reporting paper, right? What this SBR topic is all about. So SBR is actually, you know, since you have got the exemption, you can understand that before this, we have financial reporting, right? Which is in the skill level paper, right? Then we move to SBR. So the expectation is completely different. Not just from the FR, but from whatever you have learned in CA, right? Whatever we have learned in CA, it is not going to be same. I think Achievers Academy. What's your name? Sorry. So Gurkirat, I would say follow this. Once you follow this, you will be able to understand, right? As I mentioned that Ind AS and IFRS is very much similar. So you'll get to know that what was there in the concepts, right? So there's no need to go through, you know, lot many concepts right now. Focus on this first, and then we'll move on to, if anything specially required for by you, just let me know. I'll share my number and everything after the session. Okay. So as I mentioned, the expectation for strategic business reporting is completely different. Now, why it is different? Because they call it professional level. right? They call it professional level. When you move into professional level, all the papers, SBL, SBR, Advanced Financial Management, Advanced Performance Management, Advanced Taxation, or Advanced Audit, is not require, means doesn't ask you to look at the concept only, right? So the expectation is that you should learn concept plus you should be able to guide. Means you are not working as an intern anymore. You should be able to guide as a manager. Means how a reporting manager would think in a particular situation. So it means you know the concept, how you will react in a particular situation, plus how you will present the information, how will you present the information to the users of the financial statement. It means that whether anything is, means if anything is going in the P&L, balance sheet or cash flow statement or anywhere, right, in what way it has been presented, that becomes very, very relevant. So here we are not going just to focus on P&L or balance sheet. Here we are focusing more on the notes to accounts as well. And there are other areas also. We will be covering everything in detail once we move further. And it also talks about the ethics piece. Because at this level, right, being a chartered accountant, it is the responsibility of the chartered accountant to make sure that whatever has been presented, right, is presented in a right manner and it's faithful. For that purpose, ethics becomes very, very important in this particular scenario. So there is a emphasis which is given under or for the ethics piece will also be very, very important in this case. Right? So let's move on to the subject and we will be focusing on each and everything in detail, right, over these 2.5 months and make sure that any query which you may have, we will try and address that queries. Right? So let's first understand that what exactly IFRS means. Because many of you are coming from chartered accountant background and you have got the exemption in this, right? So what exactly IFRS is? Anybody guys? Yes, full form. So full form is International Financial Reporting Standards. The way we have ICAI in India, right? So ICAI along with MCA notify any accounting standard. Right, the way we have ICAI in India, which notifies accounting standard, there IFRS are getting notified by International Accounting Standard Board. Right, so International Accounting Standard Board is the body which is exactly similar to ICAI or MCA, you know, collectively the responsibilities which are there, right? So they release any any new accounting standard and the structure and everything we will discuss in detail later on, right? What IFRS covers. So when we talk about IFRS, IFRS has all the accounting standards. Or all the reporting standards. Now, what all these reporting standards which we have? This includes IFRS 1, IFRS 2. Why I am writing these ones? You will just understand. You don't need to remember all these right now. It is just to explain that what exactly we are talking about here up to IFRS 17, right? So IFRS 1 to IFRS 17, it covers. It also covers not just IFRS standards. It also covers IAS 1, IAS 2, IAS 3, IAS 4, and so on up to IAS 41. Anybody who is not able to join, I guess everybody is here only, right? So as I mentioned, so it covers IFRS and IAS both. So when we pick any particular topic, their name means their nomenclature could be anything. It could be IAS, it could be IFRS. Everything together forms IFRS, which is International Financial Reporting Standards. It also covers guidances, which is known as IFRICs. So IFRIC 1, IFRIC 2, and so on up to IFRIC 18. Similarly, it also covers some guidance notes, which is known as SIC 1, which is Standard Interpretation Committee. If any committee means if any information which has been given, right? So if any information which has been released by the accounting standard for which a specific, concept or specific industry has a different rule, that covers here. So IFRS together forms part of this. So when I say IFRS, it means IFRS 1 to IFRS 17, IAS 1 to IAS 41, IFRIC 1 to IFRIC 18, and SIC 1 to SIC 21. IFRIC means International Financial Reporting Interpretation Committee. And SIC means Standard Interpretation Committee. Is that okay with all? So this covers all four. So this is the body actually which has been formed, right? Prior to this, it was International Accounting Standard Committee, right? So since this body started, it is not-for-profit organization. This body started working on, harmonization of the global accounting standard, right? Every country was following their own accounting rules earlier, right? So this body came up and said that they want to develop some accounting rules which can be common to everybody, right? So since then, they are actually developing these ones, right? Which act, don't really know, right? Okay. So this was about that what IFRS covers, right? Now, talking about the first accounting standard. Why first accounting standard? Because again, you are coming from different background and different background. When you are coming from different background, you should know that what all financial statements do we prepare in IFRS. Right? What all financial statements do we prepare in IFRS? Okay? Because there you follow, in IGAAP you follow different rules. Here we follow different rules. Right? Now what all statements do we follow or do we prepare? What are the statements do we prepare? Balance sheet, right? So balance sheet here will be called as statement of financial position. Is that okay with all? P&L would be called here statement of comprehensive income. Now when we are saying statement of comprehensive income, it means that there are certain incomes which were not recorded in profit and loss account, right? So there are few items which could be my income but never goes to my profit and loss account. So there, this forms part of two things. One is P&L and other one is other comprehensive income, which is known as OCI, right? So P&L everybody knows. OCI, I guess only Dipanshi knows, right? Has anyone heard about other comprehensive income earlier? Okay. Can anyone tell me what exactly other comprehensive income is? So what exactly it says, if we have statement of comprehensive income. So statement of comprehensive income has two parts. One is the profit and loss account, which we all know. All expenses, right? We get profit or loss here, right? That's what profit and loss account is, right? But it has one more part. That part is known as other comprehensive income, OCI. This includes those items which never get routed through P&L. Means it would be my income, it would be my expense, but it will never be routed through profit and loss account. Can you think about any income or expense which cannot be routed through P&L? I'm not talking, exactly. So Akansha has mentioned this. So one of the expenses or one of the income is revaluation gain. Means if my property value goes up, no, not really. So Gurdeep, this is not something like that. Anything which used to go in P&L will remain be there, right? So don't mix it up with, right, extraordinary items. So all extraordinary items will still be going in the profit and loss account. These are not going to go in other comprehensive income. Here we are talking about some of the incomes which never go through profit and loss account, like revaluation gain. Some which you will never, or you may say that they have never been told to us that should go to OCI, like actuarial gains and losses. Right, foreign currency translation reserve. If I have any investment in, let's say, foreign business, and dollar rate or currency rate changes, at the end, if any difference comes up, that difference will not go here. That difference will come to other comprehensive income. Okay. Then change in fair value of some of financial assets. I won't say everything, but some of the financial assets, right? Their change in value goes here. And last one is when companies get into hedging. You can make a note of these five items, which goes to other comprehensive income. Not really, again, I won't say that these are not getting materialized. Right? These are the five only items which goes here. Right? And one more item which goes here is tax related to all five. This is IES 1. Dikshant, you will get notes also. We will share the notes also, right? So don't worry. But we will be following this book of BPP. Is that okay? So we are following book of BPP. Those who have the book, it's fine. Those who have not ordered the book, please do that now. Okay. So these are the items which goes to P&L and other comprehensive income. Is that okay with everybody? This is BPP, not Kaplan. Right. So I hope this is fine with all. So these are the two items which we have discussed. Anything else? So you can buy BPP from so you need to buy both. So study text or workbook, plus revision kit also. So it's better you buy a complete set. Okay. So which are the other items? Cash flows, which we call statement of cash flows. We have notes to accounts. Right, notes to account is same here also. Does anybody know the fourth one? So fourth one is, which has been introduced in IGAP also now, statement of changes in equity. So what is statement of change in equity? We also call it in a short form, SOC. So what is this SOC means? SOC means nothing but a reconciliation, right? So if I just talk about what exactly it means, this exactly means a reconciliation of equity items from beginning of period to end of period, right? For example, what all items goes under equity, which is share capital, share premium, retained earning, other reserves. Now, what was the balance of this on 1st April 2019? Let's assume 1,10,000, 8,999, 9,000. Now, this is the balance on 1st April 19. What is the balance on 31st March 20? How this balance would get changed? What would be the change in the balances? Why my share capital can change? Right, issue of shares or buyback. Let's assume I have issued shares at the premium of 10,000. Right, why my retained earning could change? So retained earning could change because of profit for the period. It can also get impacted with dividend, right? So 10,000 profit, 5,000 or 4,000 dividend, right? So this is nothing but the reconciliation which we are preparing for this. I hope this makes sense to all. Statement of cash flows, everybody knows, right? Notes to accounts, everybody knows, right? So is there anything, any statement where you are not clear right now? Any statement where you have any doubt? Are we clear with the concepts of the new names, which is statement of financial position, statement of comprehensive income, statement of cash flows, statement of change in equity, and notes to accounts? So which profit we are going to pick in equity? So P&L is the free reserve which can be distributed also. And where exactly it should go? This comes from P&L. Whereas OCI is nothing but the other reserve. So OCI would impact my other reserves. Is that okay? Asjad? So when we talk about retained earning, you have to pick from P&L. When you talk about other reserves, means relevant reserves, then the number would come from other comprehensive. What is the format, Darshan? We will look at the formats and everything. Though I have actually made the format here, right? This is how this format works. Okay. Azad, can retained earning have a negative balance? Yes or no? If company is making losses and losses and losses, will it have negative balance? Yes, of course. Right? Same thing goes to other reserves also. So Kavita, okay. No, it's fine, right? So it says income, right? So that is, I can understand, but it, as I mentioned, that it has some incomes and expense item also. Why these items doesn't go through profit and loss account? We will discuss these ones once we move on to each and every topic. This is just the format we are discussing, Kavita. we will be moving that revaluation gain, which revaluation gain we are talking about, right? Are we talking about revaluation gain on property, plant and equipment, or on the fixed assets, or we are talking about intangible assets, right? So we will discuss everything in detail, right? Right now it is just a statement which we need to know that what exactly OCI means, because tomorrow when we will discuss any particular topic and I take the name of OCI, so you should remember that what OCI actually is, right? So you can see that there are lot many areas which we are going to cover here. I will start with first topic, which is non-current asset. Chapter number 4. I will share notes also, right? So don't worry about it. But the reason why we are going through the book, because what happens generally is that after doing everything, you need to go through book also, right? You cannot ignore book, right? So if you cannot ignore book, it's always better that we follow book from day one itself, right? So our first chapter is chapter number 4, non-current assets. So non-current assets has different topics which are mentioned here. So property, plant and equipment, impairment of assets, fair value measurement, intangible asset, everything. So I'll start with the first one, which is property, plant and equipment. And the topic number is IAS 16. What is property, plant and equipment? If you remember, we were having, if you are coming from CA route, we have studied a chapter called fixed assets. So this is AS10 exactly. So this is exactly similar to what we are talking about here. So property, plant and equipment, what exactly fixed asset or PPE, because their name was also changed. AS10 is no longer fixed asset. It is now property, plant and equipment. Okay. So what exactly property, plant and equipment is? Asset which is used for, right, or I would say tangible asset which is used for, can anyone tell me the definition of this? Production or supply of goods or services, rental, so used to earn rental income or used for admin purpose. Now, for example, let's say machinery, trucks, aircrafts, telecom tower, everything. Right now here you can say Zoom car has cars, or earth moving machineries, the road rollers and everything. Nobody buys that. They take it on rent from someone. right? They take it from rent for those companies who actually own them, right? So they have those assets with them, which they rent it out to others, or some offices, furnitures, etc. Right. So tangible asset, which is used for these purposes, and it will last for 12 months, means life would be more than 12 months. Is that okay with all? Right. I hope this is fine with everybody. Now, at what value do we consider them? What is the value of the property, plant, and equipment which we consider in the books? So at the time of recognition, at what value we keep it at? Cost. But what is cost? What would be the cost for the asset? Historical cost. When recognition means when you are buying the asset. What would be the cost? Cost means purchase price less any discounts less any non-refundable. Plus any non-refundable taxes. If I'm going to get any sort of refund in the taxes or tax credit, the way we get that in GST, right? So we are not going to consider those taxes here, right? Plus any kind of import duties. Right, plus any directly attributable expenses. Now, what do you mean by directly attributable expenses? Directly attributable expenses means expenses which are required to bring the asset to location and condition in which we want this, right? Is that okay? So what could be my directly attributable expenses? Any thoughts? Like transportation cost. Very good. Installation, professional expenses. For example, I need a lawyer to write a agreement for me. So without agreement, I cannot buy that asset. I need a property consultant to show me the land. Right? I cannot buy without him. All these will become my directly attributable expenses, including the test run. It also cover decommissioning cost. What do you mean by decommissioning cost? Anybody who knows about decommissioning cost? What exactly decommissioning cost is? Amount required to decommission the asset and restore the environment in the same condition as it was at the time of initial recognition. Right? So anything which is required to dismantle and restore after the useful life. That would be capitalized. Now, you will just take an example. Let's say ABC has set up mobile tower on client's place. As per agreement, ABC has to remove this tower after 10 years. Cost of tower is 1 crore. Decommissioning cost is 10 lakh. Now, what we are going to do with this? What would be the cost of tower now? So the cost of tower would be 1 crore plus decommissioning cost. Now, how much decommissioning cost we should capitalize today? Right? We are not going to capitalize 10 lakh. We will capitalize present value of 10 lakh. So 10 lakh divided by, let's assume my rate of interest is 10%. So I will get the present value, and this present value would be added. So my asset value here would be this much. Is that okay with everybody? Why it is not 1 crore 10 lakh? Why it is 1 crore plus present value? The reason being that because the amount which we are going to incur is not the amount we are incurring today. The amount is going to be incurred after right, 10 years. Right, so that is the reason why we are going to capitalize it that way. Now, how this will go in the balance sheet? So in the balance sheet, in the asset side, we will have tower. of this much. How much amount I have paid? I have only paid 1 crore. Rest of the amount I have not paid. So that would be shown in the liability side as provision. The amount which we have to pay after 10 years will be shown in the liability side this way. Is that okay with all? Yes, guys. Is that fine with everybody? Requesting all to confirm. Okay. Right. So few people have question, and I guess these are very good questions which we are asking. Anyone has anything, please do ask, right? Don't. Now thing is that what would be my depreciation? Can we claim depreciation on decommissioning? Right. You cannot claim depreciation on decommissioning in the tax. Right. But in accounting, what we are going to do, we will depreciate this tower over 10 years. Right. Is that okay with all? So my value after 1 year is going to be this much. So my depreciation would be on the total amount which I have capitalized in the books. And the total amount which is capitalized in the books is 1,03,85,000. Okay, this will go to profit and loss account as an expense. Now the question is, how much we have to pay at the end of 10th year? Are we going to pay 3,85,000 or we are required to pay 10 lakhs? We are not required to pay 3,85,000. We are required to pay 10 lakhs. How this will become 10 lakhs? Because I have taken the present value, means I have taken the interest out. So every year I will charge interest on this at the rate which we have used here. So this interest will also be going in the profit and loss account. So every year, the interest component will get added to the value of the provision. And at the end of the 10th year, this will become 10 lakh. Is it okay with all? Forget about tax component right now. So we will not going to discuss about tax component here. We will only discuss about tax component when we'll move on to tax topic. Okay. What all is covered under employee benefits? Can anyone tell me what exactly employee benefit means? So salary of everybody who is involved in getting that machinery there, right? Maybe the labor who is involved in, you know, handling all the machineries, right? Now that includes salary, gratuity, pension, shares, anything which you are giving to them. During that period, when my asset was commissioning, everything which I have paid to those persons which are directly attributable, everything will be calculated or considered as employee benefit expense there. Is that okay with all? Exactly. The reason is, otherwise how we are going to make sure, right? Is everyone okay with what we have discussed? Okay. So that was about initial recognition. Right? We have subsequent recognition as well. So initially we keep it at cost. And what is cost? We have already seen. Subsequently, we keep it at either cost or revaluation. So subsequently, we have two models, either cost or revaluation. So guys, let's take a quick 10 minutes break. Is that okay? Okay, so let's take a break here. Considering that we are having the first session today, we will try to cover only 2 hours today. Tomorrow onwards, we will be doing full 3 hours, right? It is the point I just want to take care of that what all it covers, right? But I thought that it's better, you know, to discuss about these ones also, at least one chapter, right? So we will cover just this much today, right, up to 8 o'clock, and then we'll leave, right? So right now I'm just taking 10 minutes break here, and then we'll start, right? Hi, is everyone back? Okay, so Nigam, you mean you are not able to follow what I'm saying? Okay. I suggest that keep asking queries. That's something I request everybody, right? Wherever you face challenge, anything, right? I am also sharing my number. I am part of that group also. So you can write me your queries at any point in time. Okay. So, coming back to this, subsequent recognition. Initially, we only follow cost model. Subsequently, we follow either cost model, either revaluation model. Now, can you tell me what is cost model? What exactly cost model is? because I assume everybody knows about these things, right? So cost model is cost less depreciation less any impairment loss. So it is there on the screen, right? So you can write. Okay. So cost model is cost less any depreciation, any impairment loss, right? For example, let's say ABC has purchased an asset for 10 lakh, right? ABC has purchased an asset for 10 lakh. Life is 10 years. Residual value is 2 lakhs. Now, can you tell me the depreciation and closing value for year 1 and year 2? So depreciation is going to be 10 lakh minus 2 lakh, right? So 10 lakh minus 2 lakh divided by 10. So 80,000 is going to be the depreciation for year 1 and year 2 both. So the value at the end of year 1 would be 10 lakh minus 80,000. And value for year 2 would be closing value of last year minus this. Is that okay with them? Now coming on to evaluation model. What does revaluation model is? So revaluation model, you need to keep asset at fair value, right? You need to keep the asset at fair value. Darshan, in every case we calculated depreciation same way. Right? So, revaluation model means you need to keep the asset at fair value. Now, I just take the example so that you get to understand that how the revaluation model works. Let's assume ABC has purchased a piece of land. For 10,000. This is in year 2019. Right? This is in year 2019. Rhythm, we will just discuss that because once we move after this, you'll be able to understand. So in 2019, land value is 10,000. Let's assume scenario A. 2020, we are following revaluation model. And the fair value of this land is 12,000. This is scenario A. In 2020, the value has gone up to 12,000. Now, how much gain we are having here? What is the gain? So company has made the gain of 2000. Now where this gain would go? If you remember, we discussed earlier, this gain would go to other comprehensive income. I hope this is fine with everybody. Is that okay? Okay, I take another scenario. scenario B. Instead of 10,000, this is separate now. In year 2020, instead of going up, value has gone down to 7,000. What is the loss? Loss is 3,000. Now, where this loss would go? So, whenever there is a gain, gain would go to OCI. But whenever there is a loss, loss would go to profit and loss account. Is that okay with all? Okay. Let's take another scenario. A1. In year 2021, means value was 10,000. From 10,000, it became 12,000. And from 12,000, it came back to 6,000. Right? It came back to 6,000. What is the loss? Loss is 6,000 now. I hope everyone is able to follow this. Where this loss would go? So the loss first would go to OCI. Up to the amount which has already been recognized in OCI and balance amount would go to profit and loss account. I hope this is fine with everybody. Everybody is replying in the same way. Scenario B1. In 2021, value 10,000, it became 7,000. In 2021, the value became 15,000. How much gain? Gain is 8,000. Where this gain would go? So similar to what we have done here, how much is the loss we have already recognized in P&L? 3,000. So that gain would go to P&L. Rest of the amount would go to other comprehensive income. Is that okay with all? So in both the scenarios, what we are doing, we are saying that the first thing which we are doing here, this is not the loss. This is a reversal of gain. If this is reversal of gain, this is loss. Is that okay? So reversal of gain, I have taken out from OCI. And loss I have charged to P&L. Does it make sense? Similar to here, this is not gain, this is reversal of loss. So reversal of loss I have done to P&L and gain I have taken to OCI. Does it make sense to all? Kanika, is that okay now? Okay. Taking one scenario so that you can understand it better with other type of assets also. ABC has purchased. It was it was a land, so we have not depreciated, but now we will. ABC has purchased machinery for 50,000, life 10 years, right? This was in 2019. What would be the value of this in 2020? Depreciation 5,000 will go to P&L, right? And value, closing value 45,000. 2021, we started following fair value model. And the fair value is 60,000. Now, what is the fair value gain we are having? How much is the fair value gain? Again, everyone, please. What is the fair value gain? So first, what we need to do, what we are comparing actually? We are comparing 2020 value with 2021 value. Does it make sense? No. So what we need to compare? We are not required to compare two different years. We are required to compare exactly the same period. So when we are required to compare exactly the same period, first what we will do? We will take the depreciation of 5,000, closing value is 40,000. Now, considering that the fair value is this, so my fair value would be 60,000. How much is the revaluation gain? Revaluation gain would be 60 minus 40. Is that okay with all? Okay. Now tell me, what would be the value in 2022? Where this revaluation gain would go? Revaluation gain would go to other comprehensive. Now, what would be the value? I started fair value model or revaluation model in 2021. That was the assumption, Ajay. Okay. Now, 2022, what is the value? Yes. So the value now going to be, I will charge depreciation on what amount? I will charge depreciation on 60,000. What is the remaining useful life? 8 years. So my depreciation would be 7,500. Closing value would be, is that okay with all? Yes, Janvi. Is everyone okay with this? Now, where this depreciation of 7,500 will go? Again, where depreciation goes? Where does depreciation goes? Depreciation goes to profit and loss account only. So the entire depreciation will go to P&L. Is that okay with everybody? Nothing would go to OCI. I hope this is fine. But how much extra depreciation we are paying or we are charging? No, Akansha, nothing will go to OCI. Is that okay with everybody? Right. How much extra depreciation you are charging on the piece of revaluation? 2500. Now, what we are going to do with this 2500? That will not go anywhere to OCI. That will not go anywhere to P&L. Means P&L, we have already taken the full amount. This will go to statement of changes in equity. And what we are going to do, I will have retained earning and I will have revaluation reserve. How much revaluation balance we are having? Opening balance. The opening balance of revaluation reserve was 20,000. How much extra depreciation? So the extra depreciation which we have charged will be taken out from revaluation reserve and transferred to retained earning. Is that okay? This is the adjustment we are doing. What is the entry? Debit, revaluation reserve, credit, retained earning. I hope this is fine with all. Nothing would impact my P&L. Reason is that any change in the depreciation will never have the impact on the profit and loss account. I hope this is fine. So this will become zero by charging 2500 every year for the 8 consecutive years. But this is not necessary. Either we can choose to keep it as it is for 8 years. And at the end of the 8 year, this is the second way. At the end of the 8 year, do minus 20,000 and plus 20,000. It means this 20,000 will come from revaluation reserve to retained earning either over 8 years or at the end of 8th year. This is the choice which anybody and can follow. Fair value would change every year. Not can, I would say it would definitely change every year. Make sense? So think about real estate. Every year the value is changing, right? If I have purchased any asset, let's say I purchased a flat in 2012, will it have same value today? No, the value would be much higher. Is that okay, Raman? Yes. Okay. I hope this is fine with all. Anybody has any question? Next year, the fair value can change again. Let's assume you revalued again and the revalued amount, instead of 52,500, the revalued amount is now 70,000. What is the difference? Difference is going to be 70,000. And where this difference will go? This difference will go to OCI, revaluation reserve. So this difference will be added here. I hope this is fine with everybody, right? if it goes down, how it will go, if it goes up, how this will go. If value decreases, let's assume the revalued amount at 30,000. What will you do? 30,000 will come here, right? And how much will go to OCI? Whatever amount is sitting in the OCI, right? Which is 17,500, which is sitting in OCI. And rest of the amount will be taken out from P&L. Is that okay? Yes, Akansha. So we are not showing anything in the OCI there because that is the equity items which are getting transferred. Okay. So whatever the difference would be, right, that difference will go to P&L as a loss. I hope things are okay with everybody. Everybody understand the cost model as well as the revaluation model. Is that fine with all? Okay. Anybody, any question in this part, right? We can then move to the second part of it. Okay. The second part is IUS, I would say 38 intangible assets. Every time, you know, when you are revaluing, you have to see what is the value, you know, what is the value on that particular date. Yes, exactly, Prachi. So we have to consider everything during that. Okay. Now, moving on to intangible asset. The topic name is or number is IS 38. Can you tell me what is intangible asset? If PP is okay, then we can move to intangible asset now. So, Dikshant, IS 16 is done. Why it is smaller portion here? Because majority of the portion is already being tested in FR paper, right? Where you got the exemption. Okay. So here we have more complex topics, right? Asset without physical presence. Now, IS 36 is impairment, right? So first we are talking about IS 38, intangible asset. Then we'll talk about it. So IS 38 is intangible asset. So it is asset without physical substance. Yes, Harshita, right? We should know that what is revaluation model, that is important, right? Now, it is exactly similar to property, plant and equipment. The only thing is it doesn't have any physical presence. Now, how you can get intangible asset, that's something this topic particularly talks about. Right? How exactly we are going to record, right? How exactly we are going to talk about, how exactly we acquire intangible asset, this topic talks about. So how exactly we acquire intangible asset? If you need intangible asset, what is intangible asset? Asset without physical substance. What could be the example? IP, patent, right? IPR, patent, goodwill, okay. Software, license, trademarks. Know-how can be, but if the know-how is with somebody, for example, let's say I am the one who has been appointed by, let's assume, VGLD. I know everything, right? That how to teach, how to deal with it. I have knowledge. Can my knowledge be treated as intangible asset? Do you think that can be treated as intangible asset? No. Why yes or why no? The reason is there is no control. If tomorrow I want, right? Tomorrow, if I want to say that I'm not going to teach, I'm going to teach somewhere else, then what is going to happen, right? It means that it is out of the control, right? There is no control over me. When there is no control over me, that know-how will also not be controlled. If the know-how is a particular formula which has been recorded somewhere, then of course it can. Is that okay? How intangible asset can be brought into the company? Either I can purchase. If I purchase, I follow the same model, which is cost. Cost means purchase price, right? Purchase price, right? Or maybe any taxes, any import duties, exactly same which we have discussed in IS. It could be received in government grant. Means government has given that for free, then in that case we keep it at fair value, right? It could be received or it could be exchanged. Means I have given one asset, I have received one asset. And finally, it could be developed internally. So this standard or this topic talks more about this particular area. What happens if it has been developed internally? Right? It could be separately acquired, it could be goodwill, it could be intern-generated intangible asset, which we are talking about right now. So this topic focuses more on internally generated intangible asset, because everything else we have already talked about in IS 16. When you are developing the asset yourself, right? When you are developing the asset yourself, they say, for example, I give one example to you. Let's say, now in COVID scenario, what pharma companies were doing? We got the vaccine now, but every pharma company, right? Every pharma company was engaged to find out vaccine for this, right? Every pharma company was engaged to find out the vaccine. Now, what exactly they need to do when they have to find out the vaccine? What they will do? They will do research, and whatever research they have done, on that basis they do development. So we call it R&D, but they are two different terms, research and development. What do you mean by research and what do you mean by development? Yes, guys. If you know the meaning, then accounting treatment of these would not hamper or would not create issue for you. What do you mean by research and what do you mean by development? Research is to find something new. Okay. What exactly new we are going to find there? Think about from the research, from the pharma company. Again, everybody is going into detail. Think about what research pharma company would do. Generic thing. Once you talk generic, because everything is generic here, then you will remember. Research on patients, like symptoms, right? Research on COVID, like source, right? Or what kind of virus it is. Research on competitors. Any other medicine is there? Right? All these things you are just studying. So research means study. Is that okay with all? Now, what this study will give you? What benefit this study can give you? Can this study give you something? Are you sure? Has every pharma company came with the medicine? Can you think about it? Has every pharma company ready with medicine now or vaccine now? No. What it means that this study can only give you guidance, but not sure whether you can make it or not. It means whatever amount you have spent here, you are not really sure whether you will be developed the medicine or not. This is just the study which you have done. Is that okay with all? When you have just done the study, the amount spent would be treated as expense in P&L. Is everyone okay with this? Because I am not sure whether I'll be able to get any benefit out of it or not. Does it make sense to all? Now, some companies which did research, they realize that they can make it. They have the capability of making the medicine, right? If they have the capability of making the medicine, they started development. Development means they started making salt, which will be, you know, which is going to be created as a vaccine. But once they started the development, right, let's assume everybody has done the research. Has everybody started development? Maybe. But has everybody came up with the vaccine again? No. So it means development also. When you have started the development, it is not sure whether you will be able to develop that particular drug or not, or vaccine or not. For that purpose, standard has given the criteria. If that criteria satisfies, only then you will be able to capitalize the amount. Right? So what is this criteria? Criteria is so these are the 6 points. Pirate. So these 6 points is that it is probable that future economic benefit will come to entity. Means you will be able to develop. Here we are not talking about whether you have developed it or not. We are talking about the intention. We are talking about that what is your thought around it. Then it is I means intention. Intention to finish the development. Means you are incurring the expense, but your intention is clear that you would like to complete the vaccination which you are making. R means resources. So resources are available with you. It's not like that any company, any small company, which is just making very small medicines, has decided that I will also make the vaccine for coronavirus. Can they do that? Answer may be no, because they may not have the resources. Fourth, ability. Means, are they able to make that? Are they big enough? Do they have system to do animal testing or not? All the licenses are there or not, right? So we need to check ability also. Then we need to check, do they have technology? And it is technically possible or not. Exactly, Kanika. So resources means that do they have finance or not? If they don't have finance, it means they don't have resources to complete. And at last, can we make estimate reliably? If these 6 points are satisfied, then capitalize the amount as intangible assets. If not, if any is not satisfied, then expense to P&L. Is that okay with everybody? Everything, right, Kanika? If you are doing development, you will do the trial run and everything, right? You will test. If you have to test, it means you need to know whether the it is reacting in a right manner or not. Right? If research will take years, whatever amount in those years you are spending, where should it go? P&L, straight away. If research is taking years, it should go to P&L. And every big company is actually doing lots of research. Be it Samsung, be it Maruti, they don't stop. They have the research and development department, which is working on something new every time. Maybe the new design, maybe the new formula, maybe the new new food recipe. Something they are always working. Is that okay with all? Right, so you can see these 5 or 6 points which we have discussed. So let me just give you the example. ABC. Dikshant, that is a very big practical question, right? And this is an assumption. Assumption, we assume that it is happening every time. Whenever you are spending money, you always assume that you will get the money. right? So ABC has spent 1 lakh in research up to 1st September 2020. From 1st September 2020, development started, spent 80,000. However, criteria not met till 31st March 21. Now 1st April 21, development with all criteria satisfied, amount spent 90,000. What would be the expense in P&L and what would be the intangible asset value? Intangible asset, we still call it R&D, research and development. Now, how much is the amount which we have spent? So anything which is spent before this, 1 lakh plus 80,000 will go to P&L and 90,000 will go to this. Is it okay with everybody? Okay. Now, the last point is amortization. Let's assume company has purchased a license of 1 lakh. Life is 5 years. What would be the amortization? Amortization means depreciation on intangible asset. So basically, allocation of amount over the life of the asset. How much would be the amortization for this? 20,000. Very simple, right? Is that okay with all? Anybody has any question in this? So as I mentioned, this topic in this particular SBR is focusing more towards internal generated intangible asset, right? It is not at all, this can be revalued, but to revalue everything, what exactly you need? To revalue, what you need? Fair value. But do you think that intangible asset has a fair value? Right? Intangible asset has a fair value? Answer is, I would say, it could be, but very rare, because it's very difficult to find out the market for intangible asset. Exactly. So no active market. When active market is not there, then, because if you talk about license, you cannot buy from market. You have to get the license from the authority, right? You cannot buy a brand from the market. You have to buy a brand from the company, right? Whose brand you want to buy. Is that okay? Yes, everyone. Requesting all to confirm. So business combination, we will discuss once we move to consolidation. That's why I have specifically not discussed that point. We will discuss that once we move on to the consolidation topic. Okay. I hope things are clear. considering this is the first session, right? We are closing our session here only. Tomorrow onwards, we will be having complete 3-hour session to make sure that everything we are covering in detail. I will be sharing note by Monday, right? All these notes by Monday, along with the Excel file which I have used here. Okay. So topics for tomorrow, we will continue from chapter 4 on, right? This is the chapter which we have just started. So we will be discussing the other relevant points from here. Sorry. So impairment of asset is there. Investment property, government grant, borrowing cost, and agriculture. So we'll be following this one. Rhythm, if you have purchased, you can do that, but I won't suggest you to do that, right? The reason being that if you follow Kaplan, we are following BPP, there would be very difficulty in this case. So Kanika, again, so goodwill comes from acquisition, right, which is business combination. So that is the reason we are not talking about here. Otherwise, internally generated intangible asset other than R&D, right? Anything which is internally generated, even the goodwill can never be recognized, okay? So up to here today, and we will be discussing from here in the next session, right? Good night, guys. I hope everybody is clear with all the concepts. Thank you. Thank you very much. See you tomorrow then.